Okay, we are live. We are live on Facebook.
Taking a photograph live on Facebook.
I'm
going to give that to you.
It's like the Oscars.
Okay, and I've got one here, which I'll bring around. And if Debbie and Michelle can take their places, and if John Thierry can come up to the front, please, and take a place at the on the expert panel. You just have to try your best. So, we're going to have an expert panel session now. We're just going to ask the experts some questions. We might even just chat amongst ourselves. We're live on Facebook, and you can see everybody there, I think. I'll shift the camera slightly in a moment. But does anybody have any questions for the expert panel? And you can ask any questions you like. You can have any comments you like. And I am going to kick it off by asking you each in turn, what would you like to see in 5 years' time in terms of genetic genealogy? And Catherine, because you have the microphone, you will start off. I should really refer to you as Caitlin. Catlin Stark. So, kick off. Where would you like to see genetic genealogy in 5 years' time?
Well, I'm Catlin Stark, and I do have two copies of the warrior gene, which, for those of you that know me, should not surprise you. I think in 5 years' time, I would like to see the $1,000 genome actually cost less than $1,000, but actually debut and be more widespread. That is what I'm waiting for. They have been saying for years that the $1,000 genome, which, you know, is like full genome testing, is going to come out. And there was a company that debuted it, and it was very limited in its scope, and I don't even think it was the full genome. But that's what I would like to see within 5 years' time, is that test to come out.
Great. At Daenerys Targaryen, mother of dragons, breaker of chains, etc., etc.
Okay, so for me, in 5 years' time, what I'd really like to see is the combination of all the databases. I'd like to see everything combined so that we can, as citizen scientists, that we can get and access the results from everybody that's in the databases.
Donna.
And once we had that, I'd actually like to see a way of being able to manage all our matches in a better way. Once I download them, I use spreadsheets to manage all my matches, but I think the sites need to do something about a way to flag matches, have better note systems, and really be able to massage the data a lot more on the site rather than us having to do it off-site.
Oh, there's lots of things I'd like to see, but I think that we will obviously see autosomal databases, 20, 30 million, maybe more. Like Linda says, combination of databases would be fantastic, but just seeing an awful lot more people, perhaps at least using GEDmatch would help on that front. I'd also like to see more people doing Y testing and big Y coming down in price to being something that is, you know, more affordable and more looked at by those that perhaps overlook it at the moment. And yeah, I agree, better ways to manage our data as it, you know, gets, as we have more and more and more data to manage, ways of managing it is going to be so important.
Thanks, Michelle.
I'd like to see a massive boost in the size of the databases, and then particularly, in particular, growth outside the US, because the US is where most of the growth has taken place. I'd like to see 100 million people or 1 billion people in the database in 5 years' time, and those people testing from the UK, from Ireland, from France, from Germany, and expanding into other markets like India and Asia, where there's not so much DNA testing these days. And Africa as well. There's huge scope for the expansion of DNA testing across the whole of the world, so that it's not so US-centric as it is at the moment.
And John Cleary.
I agree with everything that they've all said. I think obviously whole genome testing is on its way, so I would like to see a situation where people will do one test, get all the relevant markers and information which they would need from that one test, so they're not going to be asked to upgrade again and again. But I think one thing perhaps I would add to what the others have said is I think we need platforms which will make it comfortable and easy for testers to read their own data. So at the moment there are platforms which are very suitable for technical analysis, and people who can work with big data to extract information and knowledge from that. But I think we also need a means where the tester can look at the data in a very good and easy to understand visual graphical layout and understand, see what there is there, and not feel I tested, I have no idea what this means. So I think the kind of visual platform for people to read their own data is also very important, especially as we move towards whole genome testing.
Well, those are some great ideas, and I think if we'd got everything that you wished for in 5 years' time, then the world would be a very happy place, and we'd be working twice as hard.
Yes.
If the DNA tests do come down in price, say to below $100 for whole genome sequencing, if we do start sharing the information across platforms, and if we do start testing people all around the world, how is that going to happen? Because even $100 is still going to be very, very high price to pay for a lot of different countries. So, Debbie, you talked about testing Africa, India, you know, the developing countries of the world. How would you see? How is it going to happen? Is it going to be individuals in these countries taking these tests, or do we need some sort of intervention on a government level or institutional level?
I think some countries, probably India, there probably is scope for big market there, but I would have thought in the short term we'd probably have to sponsor tests in Africa. And it's disappointing that 23andMe launched a global initiative recently to get samples with four grandparents born in specific African countries, but they were only looking at people living in the US. I'd love to see some of the companies doing more sampling in all these countries where we have a very poor representation.
I think the 23andMe African Roots project, which aims to recruit, if I recall, 10,000 people who have four African grandparents born within the same 30 to 50 kilometer region. So it's very similar to what we've done actually with the People of the British Isles project, the Irish DNA Atlas project. I think it's laudable they're trying to do the same sort of thing with the Roots into the Future African DNA project, but what's the current status of it? Because I have not seen anything advertised about it since it launched about 3 or 4 years ago.
They are supposed to be rolling out an update to the ancestry competition, and people were actually reporting on Facebook just, I think it was yesterday or the day before, that they were getting new results. And I was told that that was rolling out, because I saw some results recently for somebody from Ghana, all parents born in Ghana, whose results were very disappointing. When I looked at the database, they didn't even have any results for people from Ghana. And so, you know, he was ending up being matched in all the companies with, you know, like Nigeria. So he was coming out like 75% Nigerian, which is complete nonsense. But that was because there was no one from Ghana in the database. All the tests are geared for people of European origin. So the companies, if they want to expand into different markets, they need to get their reference populations set up so that the tests are more appealing. Because at the moment, it's very disappointing for someone of African origin. So even like living DNA, which gives fine scale breakdowns in the UK, if you look at the test for someone of African origin, they don't get any regional breakdowns at all, and they get the country wrong. So
I think Ancestry is the one that does best in that regard at the moment, because they break Western Africa into 6 blobs, which is better than just the one blob you get with Family Tree DNA. And I think also with 23andMe, you're still currently just one big blob in sub-Saharan Africa. Hopefully that will change as they start analysing and incorporating the African DNA Roots Project data into their reference panel, but we still wait to see if that's going to be the case. But it is changing, and I think several people made the point that they'd like to see the databases increase, and maybe with 35 million people in 3 or 4 years' time, we are going to see major changes. I work with a few Irish adoptees, including some mixed race Irish adoptees, African father, and Irish mother, and I actually found the African father, the African family of one of the mixed race adoptees. So now what we are waiting to do, what we're planning to do or hoping to do, is contact the African family many of which are still living in Africa. So it is possible, and this will change a lot of things for mixed race adoptees especially, but also for people who have African ancestry. Now, Michelle, you, I think, mentioned you'd like to see more people in the databases. What do you think is going to happen to genetic genealogy when there are 40 million people in the databases?
I think that we're going to see an awful lot more surprises. Adoptees are going to find it easier to find out where they came from. It's going to be easier to work out NPEs and unknown parentage, etc. Because most of the time when someone tests, you're going to be able to find a first or second cousin that you're going to be able to work from and get the answer. I hope, what I really hope, is that more emphasis is put on cousin matching and less on ethnicity. It's probably not going to happen, but I would love those 30, 40 million people to understand that they're going to get cousin matching and to be on board with that and to want to work with that. I think that that would be a huge thing for genealogy in general, not just genetic genealogy, if more people who tested were wanted to build trees and wanted to get involved in that side of it. But of course you can't, you know, people have every right to test for whatever reason they want to test. But I think that there's just a lack of information at the moment on what you get and on the fact that the cousin matching is there and what may happen with the cousin matching. So yeah, I think that it will be a huge benefit for genealogy and, you know, for the kind of people that the kind of cases that I work on in terms of adoptees and unknown parentage. And what Debbie's saying is a really, really important point about more diverse databases and more people in other countries testing. And that's something I would really love to see too. I have two cases where it's an Indian father that we're looking for. And in one, there's just absolutely nothing, you know, in the first sort of five pages of matches on any of the sites, I can pinpoint every single match is on the mother's side and the mother is Scottish-Irish, you know. There's nothing on the Indian side that I can do anything with. On the other, there is one reasonably close match that I think is around a second cousin once removed match and on the Indian side, but these are emigrants to the United States. And that at the moment is the only way for, you know, India or countries like that, that we are going to find close enough relations to work out a mystery. So what we really need are people in India testing and people in the different countries testing in order to work that out. And that would be my hope as the databases expand.
Great, and does anyone on the panel think there's any particular challenges associated with having a database of 40 million people? Donna?
I don't, I think it'll actually just make life easier. I mean, I'm finding that somebody says, oh, you're lucky when you get a match if you can find it straight away who that match is. But I actually find that the more work I do, the luckier I get. So if we're getting lots and lots of matches and we're able to place them, when a new match comes in, I got a new match yesterday and I solved it in 5 minutes. So I was literally getting up for a cup of coffee before I walked over here, got a new match, solved it because of all the shared matches that I'd already solved and she just slotted right in. So I think it might make things easier, but you know, then we get, you know, more MPEs, more adoptees, and we may find we're not actually exactly as we all think we are.
Sure. I was wondering though, I mean, we always have the perennial problem of privacy or discussion about privacy, security, confidentiality. Do you think that's going to change, Linda, at all? Or are we still going to have the same kind of discussions in 5 years' time as we're having now about privacy? Or is the size of the database going to create new risks in terms of privacy and maybe civil liberty groups saying, oh, we want this shut down?
Yes, I do feel like privacy issue is going to become more of a concern and also a more secure. I think that mainly because so many governments are concerned about it, insurance companies are concerned about it, and in my own particular case, I have a privacy issue where I, you know, the person just does not want it known
a scandalous thing that they did not want known, and so I've just kept that to myself. I have not even shared it with the rest of our family. So privacy is a really big, and it is going to continue to be of concern, and I think we are going to see our governments try to incorporate laws to protect people. So in 5 years' time, it's going to be even more so.
And I think what we've seen ourselves over the course of these last 5 years, these last 10 years, is that the standards and the regulation and the restrictions around DNA testing are getting tighter and tighter all the time. And a lot of that is, of course, self-regulation. So a lot of the companies like Ancestry, they're self-regulating. We have in Europe, of course, now the new GDPR coming in fairly soon, which will bolster the privacy laws across every industry, not just genetic genealogy. And that is making the companies change their terms and conditions, their privacy statements, and so on. But Catherine, do you think self-regulation of the genetic genealogy industry is going to be enough in the future?
I don't know if it'll be enough. Maybe it'll be a combination of the two. I do appreciate all the work by the genetic genealogists in Europe who've been working on standards for the GDPR for ISOC to recommend. The GDPR debuts in May of this year, so we've been working on our reviewing standards, and I appreciate it immensely. I think we will see more in the future of governments taking a proactive approach. Hopefully they will do things like follow California's example. In the United States in 2008, President Bush signed into law the Genetic Information and Non-Discrimination Act, which protects people from having their DNA used against them for insurance and employment purposes. However, California has expanded upon that. I wish the other 49 states would follow California's example. And it's just such a simple thing. Alex Padilla, who's now our Secretary of State, when he was a senator, he added the words genetic information to the things that you could not be discriminated against. So California has one of the strongest protection rules like that. So I think in both countries and in individual states, et cetera, that we will see much more of that.
Now, of course, taking the American example, there was a movement to try and repeal the GINA law in America. Can you tell us a little bit about that and what your reaction to it was?
It actually happened right quickly after Trump was sworn into office. There was a group of legislators that wanted to repeal it, and I think in part it was backed by business and commerce, because that's where a lot of it has come from in the past, because employers want to be able to, you know, not hire someone if they think that it's going to cost them, basically, to put it in a nutshell. Initially, my own thought was, you know, the way that legislation is in the U.S., sometimes it takes a long time for a bill to come into being, and some of them don't even make it to the floor, so I had a very wait-and-see attitude, but it's actually still ticking along, so ISOG may eventually need to, counteract that. Another one, too, is that recently came out in the news is Senator Chuck Schumer, who's from New York, wants the Federal Trade Commission, FTC, to come in and, give an opinion, or I'm not entirely sure what he's calling for, but he wants more, standards. It could be regulation, could be legislation, but it's not really specific in the media, so we don't know yet what he's asking for, but as it goes along like that, I think we'll see more of it. So genetic genealogists, and especially ISOG, has tried to be very proactive in coming up with standards and things like that to address these things. You know, that's why I said proactive, because we're doing it in advance and not being reactive.
Mm-hmm. And that's great to hear, because I think one of the things that turns people off DNA testing is, will this be used against me? You know, will it tell me medical risks? Will my insurance companies get hold of the information? Which is going to be a perennial concern. We're always going to have that. One of the other things that was said to me recently, though, is that it can actually be used for good, in the sense that if employers have your genetic information, they can actually advise you on screening programs. They can actually maximize your optimize your health behaviors that is one possible advantage of having employers have access to your genetic information. The big question is, would they use it responsibly? And that is always going to be the big issue.
The only one I know currently that's possibly doing that would be Kaiser Permanente. It's a HMO, Health Medical Organization, based primarily in California. And several years ago, Kaiser did put out the call for people to submit their genetic data to so that they could research it. But I know some people refused to do it and did not want to participate because they didn't get the results back. So Kaiser was maybe a little proprietary with it, and you know, seeing what is in people's data and then not sharing the results with them like you would get if you had done a 23andMe test. So anyhow, because they are an HMO and it's a health maintenance organization, they perhaps would be a proactive employer in that respect, but that's the only one I can cite.
John, do you have any idea what's happening in the UK in terms of medical insurance and genetic information non-disclosure?
I don't know anything specialist I can add to what Catherine's just been telling us. I'm trying to think what may be different in the future when many millions more people test. I for one wouldn't want my employer to have any access to my whole genome. Apart from anything else, if there were things in that genome that would predict the likelihood of me going down with a particular disease or condition at a certain age, that might make my employer behave towards me in ways that I wouldn't want them to behave towards me. So I think that's one of the big privacy issues which we face. And I suppose that would be one that would be significant if a lot more genetic data we put into public databases. I'm also trying to think through what it is that we object to in terms of insurance companies. And the problem there, of course, is that even if you're older and you're not necessarily interested in getting life insurance yourself, you may have genes that your children or your nieces or nephews who are younger may have, and that may be information that an insurance company could begin to use against them in pricing life insurance or other kinds of products. So I don't know how we're going to deal with this, and I think ultimately there is a tension between our desire as genealogists to have public access to data and to know what chromosomes we match various people with on, and that does depend on semi-public or platforms like GEDmatch, in which you can put in anyone's number once you have that number and see if they match anything with you, whether you know them or not. And that's very convenient if you're researching a genealogy. But ultimately, with a database of 30, 40 million or whatever it's going to be, there are definitely dangers there. Anybody could put my number in if they knew it and find out what alleles I had in particular places. And so, yeah, I think there are big implications. I don't really know how we're going to handle those.
It's a very, very good point, because of course a lot of people post their GEDmatch kit numbers on Facebook.
I have. Yeah,
yeah. And that they are usually in closed groups, so there's a degree of protection because of that. But I've seen it in some public groups as well. Mm-hmm. So people need to be aware of the risks, need to be aware of the challenges, and take the appropriate protective behavior. Any questions from the audience? We have Susie.
I just want to say that I belong to Kaiser, and I did the gene test at Kaiser. And one of the reasons I did it was because by the time I was ready to reproduce, my father had been dead for 25 years, so they'd gotten rid of his medical records. And so I would have wanted to know what risk factors I had, because I'm kind of in genetic counseling before I had kids. And so that's why I did it, was not just for myself and for my curiosity, but also for my own children.
Did Kaiser share the results with you?
Not yet, no.
Okay.
I haven't tried. I just saw it as a benefit for my own children.
Great. Another comment here?
I'm just interested to know what's happening in China and Japan, talking about other countries in the world. Do they have any interest in this area?
Interest in China and Japan. Michelle?
Yeah, that's a dirty question.
I know in China they're not, strictly speaking, allowed to send their DNA out of the country, but that is not necessarily the case, because I've got someone in my project who's actually an expat living in China, and his results arrived, his test arrived quite happily from China to Family Tree DNA. I think living DNA are actually quite active in the Asian markets, and I think there is quite a bit of interest in Japan.
They're not doing their own testing.
They don't have their own companies.
There is a company in China, WeGene, who do it's like a sort of the Chinese equivalent of 23andMe. I don't know of any Japanese companies.
I'm surprised at that.
There may well be, but the Chinese are spending an absolute fortune, state funding genetics research at BGI. They're spending more than anyone else in the whole world on genetic testing.
Brad Larkin.
I was just going to echo what you're saying. I think they're spending massive amounts. I think they're the biggest customers for the sequencing instrument producers, and they see it as a strategic asset, and they're trying to compile a large set of database that may not be public for us, but I think it's very active. And it's probably, I'm sure the sample count is probably exceeding ours, but they're not publicizing it.
Yes, Jared Corker believes very, very strongly that China is going to take the lead in genetics. Over the course of the next decade or so.
Are they testing in China? So they're actually...
Is the lab actually in China? They're doing
They're doing lots of research in China, so they're doing sequencing in China. They've got a huge complex at BGI where they've got all these sequences. So I'm not clear of the full extent, but I think we're going to see the results in the next 5 or 10 years or so.
Great. Any other questions or comments? Do the expert panel want to ask me any questions? Fine. Well, in that case...
Do you want to ask a question? Well, my question for you is the same question you started out for us. What do you want to see in 5 years?
That's what I was going to say.
Okay.
Well, I would echo everything that was said on the panel. I think what I would like to see in 5 years, maybe something that wasn't really voiced specifically, would be make it easier for beginners to know what the heck we're talking about. that would be something that's really, really important, and it's something that I can see people nodding in the audience. Something that a lot of people say, you know, it's really interesting to hear you guys, you know, and I only understand 10% of it, but it's really fascinating what you're actually doing. And it's true, because we have the most fascinating hobby, the most fascinating citizen science projects in the world. And I think finding ways to make it much more accessible for beginners would be a great benefit to everybody. So that's what I would like to see in 5 years' time. So we've run out of time. I'm going to kneel for this last bit so that they can see me on Facebook. We've run out of time. It's been great to be here in the Titanic Centre in Belfast for hopefully the first time of many. Thanks to everybody who's stuck it out for the entire 2 days of the conference. Thanks to everybody on Facebook who've been watching us. And thanks very much to our expert panel and all our speakers. Please give them a very warm round of applause. Thank you. We shall see. Ciao, folks. See you again, if I can turn this off. I need my glasses. Bye. Grand. Well, that seems to have worked.
Actually, to answer your question, I was thinking the fact that you live stream and upload all the videos, you do the most to actually help people to understand.
Interesting. That's kind
free.
Of you to say.
That's
yes.
True. And so you do a lot to educate, and you're doing it freely. You're not charging them.
That's true.
Yeah, and it's just also a matter of they have to have the incentive to want to learn.
And that's true as well.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's always great because we always have more newbies here. I had 3 today come up to me and tell me they enjoyed my talk yesterday.
Oh, fab.
No, that's really good.
I haven't had anyone insulted. That's always a first.
You haven't insulted anybody?
No, no, I mean,
you're slipping
getting
up.
Getting myself insulted. Anyway.
Okay, well, now that's good. That's good.
Sucked. It was too complicated.
Yeah? Hi.
Hi. That was really interesting. Sorry, I missed your talk. We had to run out. I understand that we might be able to see some of these lectures, anything that we've missed.
Sure.
On Facebook if we join the ISOG.
Genetic Genealogy Ireland. If you search on Facebook for Genetic
Genealogy
Ireland,
uh-huh.
and then you'll and just join, I'll join you up.
Okay. So I'm Joan. I'm Joan, and I'll be asking you. And so will Lindia at the back. We saw mostly everything.
What is your what's your Facebook?
Oh, Joan something.
What's
I
your?
Don't know, I'm not very active.
Oh, you don't use your surname.
Oh yes, I do.
Oh, what is
Joan Riddell? RIDDELL. Riddle.
Are you anything to Gail Riddell?
Yeah, I'm on her group.
Right.
We're not related, apparently.
Which
I think
one
I
is
come
you?
From a. I don't have a face. No, straight up top. I'm usually up early.
Joan Riddell Worth School, self-employed.
No, that's not it.
That,
that might
one
be
there.
Me. I've got no idea. It could be that one.
Timelines, friends, nothing to show. English, Polski.
No, they're not me. I should put
bad.
A photo up, shouldn't I?
Let's go back and see if you're the
you
other
can
one.
Always
I can find you.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's Genetic Genealogy Ireland, and they're all going to be there.
There's one there.
Let's try that one. Is that you? Level completed. Joan Riddell, Farm Heroes Saga.
It's not me.
No,
these are me. I'll forget
Fine.
It. Listen, I'll find you.
Grand. Yeah, no, do indeed.
Are you here too? You local in Belfast?
No, I'm Glasgow. I'm in
Scotland.
Yeah, no, flew over for it. So
okay,
we came over.
Have you met Michelle yet? Because Michelle lives in Glasgow.
And what does she do?
She's a genealogist.
All right.
Yeah,
oh no,
yeah.
But I'm not a genealogist. I actually have to like
well,
work
the,
for a living.
I think
but
they
I did
do DNA stuff in Glasgow. Don't they have a DNA interest group there?
I'm not
Let's
sure.
Ask
actually,
Michelle.
Ask ask
yeah,
Michelle and see what she says.
Yeah, no, we're fascinated and. I want to see all the lectures. There was things that I missed, or actually
sure.
need to see them again.
Well, we've got everything recorded there, so it should be quite good.
You saw me nodding.
I did.
I'm
I did.
I did the Strathclyde PG there, but I didn't go any further because I was busy. But I'd love to.
Yeah.